in a world where gender equality is continuously explored and debated. In Islam, the status of a woman is regarded as incredibly high. There are several references in the Quran to the status of a woman in Jannah, whether she is a family anchor, such as a mother, a doctor in the sacrificing front line, a teacher to post-generation, she will always play a global role that makes an enormous influential impact. She in Islam will guide you to see her under virtuous Islamic features. Hello everyone, welcome to a new episode of She in Islam. Today we will be hosting Ms. Farah Naqvi, which is a researcher, writer, and behavioral scientist. Ms. Farah Naqvi is an Indian national. She works as a researcher, writer, and behavioral scientist. She got her doctoral degree in management, and the area of her research was emotional labor in education sector. After finishing her studies, she worked in many different institutions and participated in conferences, presenting her research work and taking management development programs.
When I was growing up in my early years, I was like hearing stories from my elder sister about the planets and the stars and the galaxies. I wished I could be an astronaut. Then I saw that my father harbored the dream that I should be a medical doctor. So I thought perhaps I could do that. But somewhere down the line, there was one subject that always appealed to me extraordinarily, and that was literature. But unfortunately, in my school, we didn't have art stream that time. And I was a person who had many friends that time. I didn't want to leave my school because of changing my subjects. So I decided to pursue my and finish my schooling from the same school, St. Mary's. And after graduating from there, when I went to my master's, in my master's, I came across some very interesting subjects like industrial and organizational psychology, counseling psychology. And these subjects, when I read those subjects, I found, okay, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to take further. Because these subjects inherently interested me and gave me an insight about me, my inner qualities, me as a person, also helped me to understand others better. So, unlike in school, like I used to, my parents used to push me to pick a certain, study hard and study consistently. But what happened in master's was just contrary. I was reading because for the love of reading, and that reflected in my grades because in all the four semesters, I ended up scoring the highest grades across the batch. So that was one area about my school. But soon after master's, I decided, okay, I got placed in my first job with IIM Ahmedabad. And then subsequently, I worked with training and consulting organizations like Center for Organization Development and some management institutions like in India, like IBA and ICFI Business School, Hyderabad. And then coming to Kuwait, I got associated with Gulf Center for University Education. And in my career, right now, it is not only confined to teaching MBA graduation students, but it is more about training, consulting, mentoring, all these aspects of management consulting. As a resource person, I take management development programs for different themes, be it leadership, soft skills, change management. So my key areas of interest, once I discovered, I found, okay, this is my area of interest, HRD, HRM, OB, OD, organization development, and all those things. But apart from this, what I realized was all through these, one thing that I had consistently loved was my love for literature. So when I came to Kuwait and I was pregnant with my first child, my daughter, so that was the time I got to invest in reading the multiple books and especially fiction. As a child, I used to hide those books inside my biggest size maths textbook and finish it, and my mother would scold me that I was glued to books and finish a 300 pages books in 1 or 2 days. But so somehow that love for literature was always there, and there wasn't me a story that I wanted to tell the students, so I thought of experimenting with writing. There was a story that was sitting in my head that was craving to be on paper, and I decided to experiment with writing. And that's how I published my first fiction novel, The Light and Blackout, of around 286 pages, and on 27 June 2019. So this book was the story of a girl, a Muslim girl named Aliza, and she's growing, has a beautiful childhood and everything, and but unfortunately she is struck by an ailment that shatters her physiologically and psychologically. She gets afflicted by it. So through this story I wanted to tell how entire story of Aliza tells how she overcomes those phases of her life when everybody was around, when she was being stigmatized or stereotyped, and she was facing the darkest times of her life, how she persevered through that and successfully overcome the challenges of her life. So this is the story of Light and Blackout. That is why I chose this name, The Light in Blackout. So because this is a story of a girl who gets afflicted with epilepsy, and she successfully overcomes those challenges and leads us to a successful life in terms of family and also in terms of her career. So that is about the book. So all these things, the principles of Islam already has these things, the daily practices nurtures these things. Second is with respect to fasting. For example, like we are talking about self-management, everybody is talking about emotional intelligence these days. So emotional intelligence, when we talk of emotional intelligence, what it is about? Basically it has four quadrants: self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, and relationship management. Now look at this particular aspect of Islam, which is Ramadan. What happens in Ramadan is basically you are not only abstaining from food and water, there are many things you, by curtailing on your lower order desires, and you are able to focus more on your spiritual nourishment. You are exercising your self-control not only in terms of your food intake or food, but you are exercising control in terms of impulse control. And we, through, if you hear the speeches of all great people, and also if you read scriptures, one of the important criteria for success in life is control over impulse control, or nafs, control over your nafs. So like currently we are going through in times of pandemic, you see, it has brought us a very unprecedented and difficult situation we are facing. Like for me, example, I'm currently located in Kuwait. My parents are there in India, and my husband's parents are also in India. They are old. They need us. We need them. We want to visit them. But their times are tough. For the children also, the times are tough. But by these wajibats of Islam, they give you the strength, the courage to persevere and carry on, because they imbibe in you virtues that deeply affect you. When you pray, you relieve yourself from stress, you relieve yourself from, it's kind of a meditation. When you fast, you learn to curtail your lower order needs and focus more on the spiritual nourishment of your soul, and it gives you further strength. Similarly, when you talk of the homes and zakat and all the other wajibats of Islam, what it is about? It's basically about sharing your resources with the underprivileged people who are lesser privileged. Now, how beautiful is this? If you see, in times of pandemic, so many people have lost their jobs. Alhamdulillah, if you have a job, you are working and you are doing well, not only you should be grateful, but by taking out your requisite homes and giving zakat, you don't even know how you might be helping a family who might have lost a job or who might be facing certain tough times. So these are the certain ways Islam helps us in regular life and also in tough times.